they've done quite a lot to change society, but this society remains as colonial as it was in 1994. Now that's precisely what happens when you engage in social practice without thinking through what it is that you want to do. So I thought that, you know, inconveniencing as it is, you know, to be talking at 9 p.m., this series that McCoy started is helpful because then we have, you know, an extended time to ponder over the subject of what it is exactly we mean by the coloniality of thought and the coloniality of society. So what I'm going to try and do today is lay the foundation for the subsequent, we're going to have a series of these, probably in total we're going to have 5 of them. So I'm going to try and lay the foundation today for, you know, the subsequent talks that we're going to have on what it means to think about decolonizing thought and what it means to think about decolonizing society. So the title of the talk today is on the coloniality of thought. You know, what it is that we refer to when we say that thought remains colonial, or in simpler terms, when we say that, you know, our universities remain colonial, the knowledge that is taught in our universities is colonial. Now, the point I want to get us talking about today is a very simple one, but it is deceptively simple. It appears very simple, but it is not as simple as it appears. Now, to make this point, I want you to keep at the back of your mind, you know, a few simple facts. One is that many of the disciplines that you study and that you are taught in the universities are fairly recent. So engineering did not exist up until about the 16th, 17th century. It's not an eternal discipline that has always existed. Chemistry is not an eternal discipline that has always existed. These are fairly recent disciplines, accounting even more recent, you know. So these disciplines that we are taught and that we study in the universities today are a fairly recent, you know, phenomenon. They emerge at a certain point in the history of a particular region of the world. They emerge at a time when Europe becomes modern. So there is nothing eternal about them, or there is nothing perennial about them. Maybe we should add, you know, the disciplines that claim even more scientificity for themselves in this list. Many disciplines in medicine, oncology, anesthesia, and all of those disciplines are equally recent. Friends, they start as recently as the 1800s. So that's the first point that I want us to keep in mind, that these disciplines that constitute modern knowledge, as they are taught in the universities today, you know, are not eternal. They do not extend, you know, to eternity. They are fairly recent. They emerge at a specific time, so they have a date of birth, but they also have a place of birth. So their date of birth is the 16th century onwards. Their place of birth is Europe. The context of their birth is when Europe becomes modern. So that's the first point that I want us to keep in mind. The second point is that often enough, all of these disciplines claim to be scientific. Now, this claim to be scientific is basically founded on two things. It is that their postulations or their conclusions are valid across time and space, meaning that they claim to have a universal validity. So people in medicine, people in accounting, people in all these disciplines claim that their conclusions are not limited in space and time. They claim that, you know, their findings in oncology are true for the whole world. Meaning, you know, in scientific terms, that these disciplines' conclusions are not spatiotemporally limited. Meaning that their conclusions are not limited in time and space. Now, I want to suggest to you that this universality that is claimed for scientific knowledge, there is nothing universal about it. I want to suggest to you that even mathematics that is claimed to be universal, that is claimed to have this universal validity, there is nothing universal about it. Now, I'll suggest to you that what is universal is something else. It is not the knowledge itself. In simpler terms, what is universal, you create human beings who think in a certain way all over the world so that then that knowledge becomes universal. What is universal is not the knowledge itself. It is that you create modern people who think in a certain way. And because all over the world you have created people who think in a certain way, then that knowledge becomes universal. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So, if it means then that it is not the knowledge that is universal, but it's people who think in a certain way that are universal, it means that the claim to universality by knowledge is not correct. What is universal is a modern sensibility. It's someone who's modern, who accepts scientific knowledge as being scientific, meaning who accepts that scientific knowledge is universal, scientific knowledge is objective and rational. But if it's not clear yet, it will become clear as we progress. Because I want to suggest to you at the end that you could create a people who think differently such that this knowledge ceases then to be universal. So if you had people who repudiated their modern sensibilities, modern knowledge would no longer then be universal. But we'll get to that point. So I thought that I should, at the outset, state that, you know, what is universal is not the knowledge itself. What is universal, in a nutshell, is a modern sensibility. Because, as I said, even mathematics that we claim is universal or has universal validity, there is nothing universal about it. So even the so-called non-temporal truths of mathematics and logic are temporal in the sense that they are understood by an agent or a mind that is determined by temporal dimensions. So you need first to have a certain sense of time in order to understand mathematics. And so once you generalize that sense of time across the world, then you can claim, or then it becomes possible to claim that those non-temporal truths of logic and mathematics are universal. Because what you have done is to generalize, you know, a certain sense of time. But as I've said, even these logics and truths of mathematics are temporal because, as we've said, they are understood by an agent or a mind that is determined by temporal dimensions. Meaning that if you were to lose the modern sense of time, you would not be able to understand mathematics. If I robbed you of the modern sensibility of time, of understanding time the way in which you understand it, you would not be able to understand mathematics. Simply, if we did away with the time of the clock, you would not be able to understand mathematics. Unless you accept the modern notion of time, of the clock, you know, that disaggregates time in terms of hours. That's the basic, that's the starting point for you to understand, you know, the algebraic formulas that you think of as universal. Because if you did not have that sense of time also, as in the calendar year or the Gregorian calendar that, you know, we use, you'd also not be able to understand mathematics. So the point, as it will become clearer, is that what is universal is not this knowledge. What is universal is something else. It's what I call, for short, a modern sensibility, a modern sense of time, a modern way of being in the world, of interacting, you know, with the world. Now, down to trying to understand how do we get to habit this modern sensibility that, you know, then enables a certain kind of knowledge that has a birth date and a birthplace. You know, how that knowledge that has a birth date and a birthplace comes to be universal. Because even without getting, or even before we get into the crux of the argument, what is it that makes knowledge that is discovered in Europe in the 16th century and the 17th century universal? What is it that makes it universal? Because it's discovered in a particular place within a particular time. So how then does it become universal? Or what is its claim to universality? Or how does that claim to being universally true come about? This is knowledge discovered by a people who are faced with a certain circumstance in a particular context. And then they respond to their lives at that particular time in a particular context. But then their conclusions and their discoveries all of a sudden become universal. How do they become universal? Why do you accept the universal principles of accounting that we are taught are universal? Because these are things that evolve out of a particular context to respond to particular situations in particular places. Now, so I'm going to suggest to you that modern disciplines and modern knowledge that you know today as being universally true and valid, as we've said, does not predate the 16th century. So from the 1500s backwards, knowledge existed, but it was not, you know, disaggregated into the disciplines as you study them today. So sociology, biology, you know, physics, chemistry, accounting did not exist prior to that, to, you know, the 1600s, or prior to the 16th century, you know, before universities disaggregated knowledge the way they do today. So there was a different order of knowledge prior to the 16th century, prior to Europe becoming modern. That order of knowledge did not aspire to be universal. It existed in Europe. There was knowledge in Europe prior to the 1600s, but that knowledge did not aspire to be universal. It did not claim for itself a universal validity. So universities are quite old. The oldest European university is the university in Sweden called the University of Uppsala. It starts in, you know, 1198 or so. But meaning there is knowledge that is produced, for instance, at Uppsala University from 1100 up until 1600 that does not claim to be universal. Because if it had that universal validity that modern knowledge claims today, it would be taught to you today. Now, this claim to universality, this claim that modern knowledge comes to have from the 1600s, you know, comes from somewhere. Its motivation comes from somewhere. So Europe transitions into the modern period in the 1600s. As we've said, it found knowledge that had existed prior to that, but that knowledge did not have any aspiration to be universal. It was particular, it was relevant to the context within which it developed. Just as it is that you had you had universities in Africa prior to modern universities as they exist today. Even if you forgot for a moment about the University of Alexandria in Egypt, there was University of Timbuktu in Mali. There was universities, you know, in the northern parts of Nigeria that existed prior to modern universities existing today. These universities produced knowledge. But at this time, universities, as we've said, had no aspiration to universalize, you know, their knowledge. Their knowledge was relevant to their particular context. But what changes in the 1600 onwards? What changes when Europe becomes modern? It is that at this point, universities began to delimit what was called knowledge. Even though knowledge had existed prior to this period, from the modern period or from the 1600 onwards, you know, there began something else which was called the delimitation of scientific knowledge. Now, at this point, there is a conscious attempt. There is a conscious attempt to characterize what is called scientific knowledge. So the object at this point is no longer just to produce knowledge, but it is to produce what you can think of as metaphysical. What happens at this moment is that you have people whose object are basically to delineate the characteristics of scientific knowledge. They themselves are not engaged in the production of scientific knowledge, but they are engaged in the process of saying, whatever claims to be scientific must have these characteristics. Now, there are three obvious characteristics that, you know, scientific knowledge would come to have from the modern period onwards, or from the 16th, you know, century onwards. One, it is that scientific knowledge had to be objective. So there is a certain objectivity that scientific knowledge comes to claim for itself. Two, this knowledge claims for itself an element of rationality. So modern knowledge is rational knowledge. So we're beginning to have the boundaries of modern knowledge emerge as these scholars, you know, were engaged in the process of identifying the meta characteristics of modern knowledge. They claim that modern knowledge is objective, modern knowledge is rational, modern knowledge is reasonable. So you have objectivity, you have rationality, you have reason becoming the boundaries of modern knowledge. Now what happens with these three characteristics of modern knowledge, you know, coming to the center is that at that moment there is an exclusion of several other knowledges that are not rational, that are not objective, that are not reasonable. So any knowledge at that period that was of sentiments, for instance, was considered not to be knowledge at all, because sentiments are not rational, they are not reasonable. So there is an exclusion, there is a beginning from this moment onwards, an exclusion of certain kinds of knowledges as being outside of knowledge, as not constituting knowledge. Now, this is exactly the same time also when there is that distinction between the public and the private realm. But the public and the private realm does not concern us, you know, today, except that it has a very close relationship, you know, with the development of modern reason, modern, you know, science, because it is considered that science, you know, is what explains what happens in the public realm. Whatever happens in the private realm was considered to lie outside of science or to lie outside of knowledge. So religion was not in science as it lied in the, you know, private realm. Private beliefs, tradition were considered to be in the private realm, and so they were no longer objects of knowledge, or they could not constitute knowledge. Now in that one stroke, when you say that modern knowledge or modern thought is characterized by being, you know, reasonable, by being rational, by being objective, you have excluded a whole array of forms of reasoning and forms of thinking that are not rational, that are not scientific, that are not objective. You said that all of these forms of cognizing, all of these forms of exercising thought, so you said all of these other forms of cognizing, all of these other forms of, you know, being in the world fall outside of knowledge. Because knowledge is what is scientific, knowledge is what is objective, what is rational. So every other thing that is not objective, that is not scientific, I mean rather that is not objective, that is not rational, that is not reasonable, falls outside of knowledge. Now this is the beginning of the moment when modern knowledge takes shape. Now this modern knowledge, even though at this point it claimed to be scientific knowledge, it could still not claim universality for itself. It still needed, you know, to give unto itself the universality, you know, of character. Because all of this, remember, is still happening in Europe in the 16th century. So those who were engaged in this project were conscious of the fact that this knowledge was evolving or was emerging in a particular place. It was emerging in a particular place, in a particular time, in a particular culture context. This is the Europe, you know, with its own culture context.